ISNA.
हाँ हाँ स्मार्ट है और इतना में परमानेंट स्पीकर है
हाँ
बट
प्रोफेशन क्या है
वो पीएचडी किया उन्होंने सोशल साइंस में
अच्छा एरिया में रहते हैं तो प्रोफेशन में
Did you have a campus over here? In,
sorry, in Charlottesville.
No, so. Oh, so you're going over there in Charlottesville?
Yeah.
100 miles.
You drive there or you live there?
Yeah, I drive. I go there. I mean, I come back every week.
You live on campus, right?
So, yeah.
I'm from
Jantia. In Charlotte, I'm very grateful to God's one of Request at this gathering. Inshallah, I will start not a particular topic, but the overview of Islam and how to understand it in modern times, how to extend it to others. That's our second duty. Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله نستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونصلي عليه الخير أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله When we speak about Islam, the general definition given by about Islam is what do you understand of Islam?
Well, I mean,
expand.
It's the religion of peace, you know, and
submission,
to God and the oneness of God.
Okay.
And Prophet, peace be upon him, is his messenger.
Say. You have similar definition or something you want to add?
Anything to add?
Nothing. That, I mean, if we're talking about the basics, those are the basics.
Pardon?
I said, if we're talking about the basic concept, that is the basic concept, that Prophet Muhammad is the last prophet and Allah is the only God.
So that comes first.
Yeah.
You
about the same.
Same.
We are learning. don't think that knowledge will grow. From one direction to everyone. You say, knowledge is a two-way
traffic.
Knowledge is a two-way
traffic. We will tell you.
It's a learning session, not just words. Alhamdulillah.
Just like a classroom.
The word Islam comes from the root Salama. It's the root. In Arabic, every concept has a root. Every word has a root. In Salama, has not only submitting, it has the meaning of submission and peace, but one more aspect to it, which generally we don't hear. That's why I was asking from you, what do we understand of by Islam? It's true, it's a general definition that you offered. It's good. But the extra dimension it has is this. Salama also means to acknowledge. If you come to believe in certain thing, after acknowledgement, then your belief has some foundation. Otherwise, somebody suggested, like my parents told me when I was growing up, Allah is one. We cannot associate anything with him. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet. Quran and other, but Aqidah itself, I'll try to expand on it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he created the human being, the first Adam, he says he gave him all the names. What it means is he gave us, in his mercy, the capability to understand phenomena around us and form concepts about it, means give a name to it. Plastic, for example, was not there even 100 years ago, but now plastic is a new material, but the human being has the capability to form a concept about it. So this cognitive capability is the key to belief. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he created human beings as the excellent crowning feature of the entire humanity, the entire creation, we are having that crowning characteristic by virtue of the cognitive power that Allah gave. No other creature has the cognitive power. So we have the cognitive power that Allah's blessing. He endowed us with the, to start with, he gave this capability. And by virtue of this capability, we acknowledge there is a being who is uncreated, uncaused. If it's caused, the agency that is causing it becomes the creator and he becomes creation. So we stop there. There is an uncaused creator. I'll come to this definition, inshallah, momentarily, in a few minutes. How the mind comes to believe in an unseen God. We can see a thing and believe, generally. The rest of the world, they are, half of them, they reject the existence of God, thinking, where is the need? He is not seen. And how to prove? They are scientific minded, so to say. So they believe in something concrete, which they can, you know, test, prove, feel, touch, and say it exists. But a phenomenon which is not accessible to our senses may not exist. So the enlightened scientists, they reject. Unfortunately, even few Muslim scientists I have met, they rejected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I dealt with them, and I will relate some of the anecdotes. It may help to understand why in the life of human being, belief in the unseen is so crucial. All the success in this world and in the hereafter, both, it depends on belief in the unseen, uncreated, uncaused God. And we have to learn as youth and Muslims, because the challenges that the modern science is posing on us, they are huge. They have evidence. When they say Darwin's theory, we reject it as Muslims, but we don't have anything to substantiate. We have arguments, but they have evidence. Although that evidence is fallacious, we can disprove it. But few of us have tried it, and if there's a time, I will talk about that too. But when I said Aqeedah starts with what? I mentioned some keyword. What was that? Acknowledgement. Allah has given that capability to acknowledge. That's why the hadith goes, Kullu mauludin, whoever is born, independent of the background of the family, a kafir family, atheist family, Muslim family, any family, a child that is born in any family, Allah has given that capability for the child to acknowledge Allah, accept his being unseen and uncaused. That capability is given in his mercy right there. Otherwise, a child who is born in a kafir family, he is doomed. He is born there, so he is born to be Christian or whatever, kafir or Christian or Jewish. But not so. Although the child may be born to a kafir, he has Allah being Rahman. Rahman means a giver in abundance without your asking. Just because he created us, he gives. The rain comes and falls on Muslim farms as well as kafir farms. Allah doesn't stop rain for the kuffar and only for Muslims. On the contrary, sometimes all the rain may come to the non-Muslim lands and Muslim lands, we undergo famine. That's Allah's mercy. But then Rahman means he is a giver of mercy in abundance without your asking, like air. Is it only for Muslims? No, it's just open to everyone. Or thought power. Now most of the scientists are non-Muslims. They are reaching Mars and Moon. Whereas after a long, good, you know, spectacular progress, which the Muslims did for 800 years, now we are at the receiving end. Whatever they make, we receive and be happy. They are not generating knowledge, and we are doing it in a minimal way and in a secondary fashion, not original inventors, discoverers, thinkers, no. So that mercy of Allah that He gives to every human being is so important in human life that it leads you to believe in the Creator. How do we impress upon a non-Muslim that he has this capability? Only he is not looking back and discovering it. It's Muslims have to first believe in this and remind them, you have this capability. And that we have not done, we are not doing. So let's learn Islam first, what it is. Go ahead, have a round of tea and I will continue. Finish it up. Let's have a cup of tea,
doesn't it?
Another one? Of the religious background has the capability, istita'ah, to become a Muslim, believe in one Allah and only one Allah. Now, other part of the hadith is, same hadith, the other part is this, but the parents of the child, they might make him Christian, Jewish, or Majus, you know, anything. That means he has the capability, but the parents are diverting him to this and that. Left to himself, he will explore Allah as the one uncaused creator. Did I answer your question?
Yeah. He has a feature basically. Whether you know he makes use of that feature or not, but that feature is like part of
the
creation.
It's the potential.
Right.
You actualize it by discovering. Like the I was giving an example of the Christian Arab the Lebanese. A young man came high school from Lebanon. He was Maronite Christian, they're very staunch Christians. But when he came here, being Arab, he was discovering his own capability to believe in God. He said, I asked him, how you became Muslim? Even by childhood, he was not going to the church. When his family was going to the church, he was playing also. And parents didn't mind. Many parents don't care. Okay, let him his own time. But as soon as he finished his high school, he came to America, he could have been lost into Christianity easily, or he could have lost to atheism. I don't care. That's easy to say. So he didn't. His mind was impelling him to discover the truth, the reality. And the reality is there is a God, all by himself, uncaused. Now, we'll talk about how the mind arrives at the concept of one and only one belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, any other question? So that we connect. Go ahead, feel free. This is an explorative session. We are exploring the reality and truth to the best of our ability.
Question is, nowadays, young generation, so our
or young children or young, they ask many times that why do I pray five times? Why should I follow the Islam? What I'm going to get out of this?
Certainly, I'm coming to that. After Aqidah, the next question is this. I will come to that. But let's sort out what Aqidah, Islamic Aqidah is so scientific. So scientific. I will dwell upon it. My research, to introduce myself, is in neuropsychology. How brain thinks. Brain is a physical entity. It's a flesh. 3-pound flesh.
Right.
If Einstein's brain they preserved, they wanted to know, such a great scientist. He gave a theory to connect everything in the universe by one simple equation. And it has not been contradicted. Time after time, they are trying to reach other phenomena of the universe. This theory gets corroborated, not rejected or contradicted. So this brain should have been very spectacular, something different from yours and mine. No, when he died, they preserved his brain, sliced it, small part of it, tested, they found it. No difference between ordinary brain and his brain. And it was even a little smaller than the average brain. So where was he getting those ideas? He discovered the space is curved. Can you see the curvature of the space? No, it's unseen. But he formed an idea about it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given that capability to every mind to form concepts even about things which are not accessible to your senses. You are not able to see it, but you can form the idea about it. Give me one example. You should be able to give me an example. You know it. When I would tell you, you say, ah, yeah, I know it. You know it.
To God,
we are talking about God and building this argument. So we'll come to that. Apart from God, I'm asking it. I give one example about curved space-time. You have heard space-time continuum, Einstein. How did you do that? Where did you get that idea of a curved space in the universe? Okay. I will come to that. So, first the human capability we are talking about. So it's understood, doesn't matter you are born in a Muslim family, Christian family, any family, being Rahman, he gave this capability to every human being. That's Rahmaniya. That is the Allah's characteristic. He is Rahim also. Rahim is, he rewards you to the extent you deserve. To the extent you show your taqwa, you build your taqwa, you show in your actions, you show in your consciousness of Allah, I should do this, I should not do this. To that extent, He rewards you, He is Rahim. In that, not only He can give you to the extent you deserve, He may give you more. That's up to Him. But Rahman is just because He created us, it is there. Your mother's love. Do you ask for it? Oh Allah, give me little mother's, my mother's love for me. No. You were just born, your flesh, helpless, but mother's love abundantly was there. When he talks about his love for us, he mentions about mother's love. Because that is unique in the universe, in human life. He gives the example, a mother. There was a war going on, people are killing each other. A child strayed and went into the thick of the battle. Being mother, she didn't care that somebody, some arrow will come and kill her, or somebody's sword may slash her. No. Her focus was only her child, not the warring soldiers, she reached there to get her child back. So he says, my love for you is far greater than that. It's a hadith. And that is the Rahmaniya. So we have to acknowledge, I said, this, the word salam has this. First step is acknowledgement. Suppose there is an electrical wire. If you know the current is passing through it and there is no cover on it, and naked wire, current is passing. But if you acknowledge there is a current, you would take some protection to hold it. You not just go and hold it. You acknowledge it, the laws of the electricity, that it will electrocute you, burn your blood if it touches and passes through the earth, short circuit. In minutes, a human life could be electrocuted, devastated. So acknowledgement is the first one. Allah doesn't say, just because I'm all powerful and all that, I am most powerful, obey me. There's no coercion. It's Allah is appealing to our thinking power, our cognitive powers, our aql. And if somebody knowingly rejects it, looks at the human natural phenomena, how the rain comes, how flowers emerge from, you know, dry land, and this and that, still the modern scientists, the entire majority of the modern scientists, including Muslim brothers I have met, they are prone to reject Allah just because we cannot see it. So we have to educate them and educate ourselves that that capability to form the concept of unseen God is right with us. That wealth, that capability is with us. How do we use this power? I talked to many atheists. One atheist was coming from France. His name was William Husserl, authority on genetics. Genes are so wonderful phenomena, you know. They make you what you are. They make you what you are. But every one of us, although you are from Pakistan, you may be from England, whatever, the genes are same. Genes are same, but they have different expression. So your nose is different, his nose is different, the way I smile is different. The genes are same, but the expressions are different. This is the Allah's, you know, power. And such a scientist, knowing the powers of genes, his authority on genetics, he didn't believe in God. William Husserl. I was a young man at that time, some time ago. He was sitting next to me, and all these scientists, they were atheists, including the director of my lab. His name was Hussein Zahir. He used to take pride. I don't believe in God. Thick words.
His name was Hussein Zahir.
Hussein Zahir.
He did not believe in God.
I don't believe. Thick voice, you know, authority. Yeah. I'm a scientist. Why do I have to believe? So to teach them, I thought he's a guest. Let me shoot a question to him. I said, do you believe in God? He said, he was sitting like this, leaning on the table, thick man, and he relaxed back. I thought he's telling me. I was young, so he was brushing me aside. So he went back and sat comfortably. Then he said, no, with such sharpness, means don't ask me. I'm a scientist. Why are you asking this silly question? But I'm a scientist too, so I didn't leave him. I didn't leave him. By the way, every child who is born, as we say, we have the capability to understand Allah and believe in Him. So every child who is born, doesn't matter where, is a scientist. I have expanded the meaning of science by discovery of new genes. I predicted existence of new genes which are responsible for thought process. I am sharing with you because you should feel proud that we have every harba in Arabic, instrument, every tool that's needed for Islam we have. In such questions people are asking, inshallah, we have to prepare you for the onslaught of challenges that you are going to face. Because the atheistic world, secular world is growing more and more powerful every day. The reason is every day we are getting at the receiving end, and we are not doing enough, which Allah has given powers. We are more powerful with the concept of the Tawheed. Tawheed is million times powerful than any atom bomb. But we have not discovered it. We are not using it properly. That's why we feel that, especially my focus is you, and if you are not prepared to meet those challenges, we have failed as parents. We have failed in our duty to prepare you, to educate you, to empower you, to reinforce you, inshallah. So the what I was telling, that every child born is a scientist. I have another paper, inshallah, which you may have the opportunity to read and understand it. Doesn't matter what your background, science is your God-given capability. Okay, so the scientist, when he rejected, he said, no, I just probed him. Look at the strategy and you will understand how human mind can do that. On the spur of the moment, I received help. I asked Allah, such a big authority is telling me no before other atheists, and they are my officers. So I cannot displease them. Some people may think, oh, they may be displeased and they may demote me or not give me, you know, cause me harm. No, at that time, I just asked Allah's help, how to answer this big giant. I gave him a small example in science, but taunting him at every statement. I said, but do you remember one scientist, German scientist, Röntgen? He said, yes, he's a scientist, he cannot say no. And why is he remembered his name? Some of you know it. I will, when I say, you'll say yes. He was a scientist working on a vacuum tube from where the air had been evacuated. He was passing high voltage current to know the behavior of current in the vacuum tube. It was a large room. At the other end of the room, he had a table, his desk. In the drawer, he had kept some photographic films in black and white, because they are subject to light. And when he finished his experiments, he wanted to use those films, and those films were exposed. So I taunted him. Being a scientist, he got curious. A scientist is a curious person. He said, how it happened? He did not dismiss that maybe I might have carelessly exposed them. No. I said, no, something is happening here. He repeated the experiment under identical conditions, placed new film there, and after he finished it, out of curiosity, again I taunted him. Being a scientist, he went there to check